let me introduce Catlyn Keenan. Catlyn is a professor of philosophy, religion, and women's studies at Front Range Community College, where she's been teaching since 2001. Her graduate work is from the Religious Studies Department at CU Boulder and the joint PhD program in Religious Studies offered by the University of Denver and Iliff School of Theology. Her areas of specialty are religion and popular culture, gender studies, and religion and violence in the modern world. Tonight's talk will offer a theoretical approach to ways of understanding religion and violence, drawing from examples in Professor Keenan's work on American militia movements and white supremacy. Join me in welcoming Professor Catlyn Keenan.
Thanks to the Longmont Library for hosting these events, and thank you for having me tonight. One of my areas of specialty and where I'm focusing my dissertation work and my doctoral program is on religion and violence. And as Kathy mentioned, I specialize in American white supremacy and American militia movements, and I'll be talking about that some. So the previous images that I just showed you are meant to be sort of provocative and to get you thinking about our assumptions concerning religion and violence. And the images you saw, of course, range from KKK lynchings of black Americans during the 1920s to Tibetan monks lighting themselves on fire in protest of the Chinese occupation of their territory right now in the 21st century. There have been a dozen or more monks light themselves on fire in protest. Yeah?
Can your sound be turned up?
Kathy? Can my sound be turned up?
I just did it.
Okay.
Can you hear me now?
I might hold it. I can probably hold it. I have a lot going on now. Yeah, why don't you give me that one? Or is that good?
Okay.
And so you also saw woodcuts of witches being burned during the Inquisitions. And a lot of just sort of rhetoric that's used around religion and violence, both from religious texts as well as other just sort of popular culture references. And so my goal here is to introduce some broad themes and theoretical approaches to understanding religion and violence. And then ultimately what I'd like to do, though, is to have more of a conversation about what you guys are interested in around this topic. So I'm going to do a 30-minute or so presentation, and then we can just sort of talk about whatever you want to talk about, really. I initially got interested in religion and violence. Well, I've always been interested in sort of religion and violence. But I got interested in American white supremacy and racist Christian Christianity. American Christianity when I was around 2008, about a year or so into my doctoral work. And I came across ways in which religious rhetoric was being used not just to rationalize or justify violence, but to actually promote it. And so I came across this movement called Christian Identity, which I'll talk about at the end of my presentation tonight, which is a form of sort of Protestant Christianity that has a very, very racist read of the Bible and uses it to justify and promote active hate crimes against Jews and people of color here in the United States. And so that's sort of where I'm located in this conversation. And sorry, tonight's talk is pretty academic. It is what my doctoral work is about. So if I get too academic for you, just wait, and I promise I'll get through it. So my purpose here is threefold. I will speak briefly about sort of the religious diversity in the world, because in my experience, people don't really know what's actually going on out there in the world with regard to religion. And then next, I'm going to move into a discussion of theoretical approaches to the question of whether or not religion is inherently violent. And then finally, I'll introduce the American white supremacy movements that I study. So, some of us believe that religion promotes peace in the world and only occasionally gets embroiled in violence. We believe that when religion becomes involved in war, genocide, and terror, that something has gone terribly wrong and that religion should be saved from its followers. The sociologist of religion, Mark Juergensmeyer, says, "Is violence the fault of religion? Has its mask been ripped off and its murky side exposed, or has its innocence been abused? Is religion the problem or the victim?" Some people believe that religion is inherently violent, spreading discord, intolerance, and bigotry wherever it goes. Because religion fundamentally works to divide believers from non-believers, it can separate human beings into categories of us versus them, I who have the truth, and you who are an unbeliever. And so because religion others, some people believe, of course you have to other someone before you can commit violence against them. That's step one. You have to turn them into something that is different from you. I am righteous, you are unrighteous, therefore I can commit violence against you. And so some people argue that religion is sort of intrinsically violent. Still other people believe that it's only particular religions that are violent, while other religions are peaceful. So is monotheism the culprit? Or a specific monotheism? Is it Islam? Is it Christianity? And so maybe it's actually a particular religious worldview in a larger context that promotes violence. And so many religions set up their cosmologies so that my God is right and your God is wrong. And as soon as I say that my God is right, it's very easy to suggest that if you don't believe in my God, that you are an unbeliever, that you should be castigated and destroyed because you are an unbeliever. So let me just talk generally about the context and sort of the what's going on out there with religion right now. So there are just over 7 billion people on this planet right now, right? About 80% of them are religious. And so this sort of agnosticism lump right here, I'll talk about here in just a moment, but if we sort of take them out of the pie, then what that leaves is about 5.6 billion people who are religious in the world. Christianity is the largest of the world's religions. It has about 33% of the population. However, to talk about Christianity as a monolithic religion is actually very inaccurate. There are more than 1,600 denominations of Christianity in the entire world. There are 900 denominations of Christianity just right here in the United States. So it's much more accurate to talk about Christianities as opposed to Christianity. Islam is the second largest religion in the world. It's around 24% or so of the world's population. It's also the fastest growing. If it continues to grow at the current rates, it will surpass Christianity by about 2050. So Christianity, Islam, and then Judaism, which is over here, and it's so tiny that you can barely see it. It's about 0.2% of the world's population. But if we add Judaism, Christianity, and Islam, which are the monolithic Western world religions, that's about 53% of the religious people in the world belong to one of these three religions. Around 20% of the world's population are agnostic, atheists, or non-believers. We call them the religious nuns, N-O-N-E-S, not nun like Catholic nun. That's something entirely different. Religious nuns, no religion, no religious affiliation, and furthermore, not much interest. And so if you ask them, are you religious, they're like, yeah, not really, and I don't care. Let's talk about something else. So as you can see, Hinduism, actually over here, about Hinduism and agnosticism or religious non-believers are about the same amount of the pie. And then you get this whole sort of breakdown with the rest of the world religions. As I said with Christianity, it's also true of these other religions that they can be subdivided into all of these different sort of ways of being a Hindu or ways of being a Buddhist. And so religion is actually incredibly diverse, and it will even vary from, you know, location to location within close proximity. This is a slice of what's going on in America as of 2010, which is when this was done. And I want you to pay attention here that these are churches, not actually people. And so if we actually look at the religious churches or temples or mosques in America, what we see is 26, just over 26% are evangelical Protestant churches. The next is Catholic churches, about 23.9%. The mainline Protestant churches is a combination of the Methodists, the Lutherans, the Episcopalians, the Presbyterians, and the Baptists. And they combine to make about just over 18%. And then you just sort of get this fallout with everything else underneath it. And so somewhere in the vicinity of around 75%, three quarters of the American population claim affiliation with some form of Christianity. The other 25% are everything else, all over the board. A very interesting and very provocative study was released last year by the Pew Forum. It said that just under 20%, like barely under 20%, like 19.7% of Americans are now religiously unaffiliated or outright atheist. And so actually we're getting this huge explosion of non-religious people here in the United States. So let me just talk very quickly, like 2 minutes, about how people like me study religion and religious people. Because I get that question a lot, like how do you actually study this? And how do you actually measure whether or not somebody is religious or not? Well, here's how we do it. So we talk in terms of religiosity, which is a person's combination of things that make a person religious, that determine whether or not somebody is religious. And the first one is reported belief. And so if we walk up to somebody and say, hi, are you religious? And they say yes, we're like, okay. And so then, if they say yes, we follow that up with questions like, okay, so as a religious person, how often do you attend religious services? And they say, oh, once a year. And we say, okay. Or they say 3 times a week, and we're like, okay. And so we can sort of, we create this spectrum. Other questions are things like, how often do you pray or meditate? How often do you offer veneration to a deity? I mean, you have to figure out exactly how to phrase these questions to create a wide umbrella. But you follow up with questions about people's behaviors. And that's how you sort of determine how somebody is religious, and then you can sort of fit them into these categories of like super religious, you know, all the way over to not religious at all. Interesting fact, totally tangential, but women are more religious according to these measures than men. And it varies by how much sort of where you are in the world and where you are even in the country, but women are more religious than men. The vast majority of people in the world belong to the same religion as their parents. Yeah?
So regarding the previous point, I have a question between a person's behaviors being religious or spiritual. Is there any way to differentiate that?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, absolutely. So people started identifying as spiritual really in the 1990s.
Yeah.
So differentiating between religiosity and spirituality is a really new phenomenon.
Okay.
And in fact, in the United, well, in the world, really, we didn't even start using the word spirituality until the 1970s. It wasn't in our lexicon, like it didn't exist as a word. However, now that people started using it, we have to figure that out, because one of the first questions you ask somebody is, are you spiritual or are you religious? And if they say, well, I'm spiritual, you're going to have a different set of questions. But I'll be honest here, religious scholars, if you say that you're spiritual and you don't attend religious services, but you pray every day, we're still going to put you in the pretty religious category. That's how we do it.
Okay.
It's not perfect. If a person experiences a conversion experience, there is a 70% likelihood in the United States and a 90% likelihood overall that they will convert into a religion that is common to their society. An Indian living in rural India is not likely to be, I'm going to be Catholic. They become Hindu. They become a more deeply devoted Hindu, or they might become Muslim. There are lots of Muslims in India. But they're going to convert into the religious persuasion of their surrounding society almost always. So that's just interesting. And then finally, religious identity is remarkably fluid. It changes a lot over the course of somebody's life. And so often what you'll see is there's this trend when somebody is, say, between, well, anyone under about the age of 12 is going to say that they're the same as whatever their parents are. Between about 12 and about 25, there's this shift in most people's lives away from religiosity. They sort of reject it. And then what happens is people, they get married, they have children, and they go right back into being religious again. Now, they may not be the same religion as their, or the same denomination as their parents, but if their parents are Christian, like let's say their parents are Catholic, the children might leave the Catholic church but then join an evangelical Protestant church. So they're still Christian, they're just a different kind of Christian. And then as people get older, this is kind of interesting too. So once they convert or not, around 25 to 30, a person's religious identity becomes very sort of set. It continues on that trajectory as people get older. So people who are very religious as young people get more religious as they grow older. And people who are not very religious as young people get less religious as they grow older. And so it's like they start this trajectory that then just continues for the most part. Okay. Religion is a big aspect of people's lives, and it must be taken seriously as a factor in human behavior. Religious identity is simultaneously fluid, as we just discussed, changing and developing over the course of a lifetime, and yet it's also very deeply ingrained in a person's sense of their own identity. We build our entire realities on our understanding of the universe and our place in it. And so challenging someone's religious belief or commitment can literally throw their cosmos out of whack. And so if we seriously challenge the fundamental belief structure of a person, it tends to cause anxiety, fear, paranoia, anger. The sociologist of religion, Peter Berger, writes, "Religion legitimates so effectively because it relates the precarious reality constructions of empirical societies with ultimate reality." And if you're not up on your Peter Berger, what that actually means is that many people feel as though this reality lacks meaning unless it is part of a larger and more permanent reality. The human experience seems to be one where we want things to be settled and permanent, and yet they aren't. They're constantly changing. What's that saying? The only constant is change itself, or whatever that saying is, right? And that makes a lot of people really, really nervous. And so if they can orient their reality to this religious cosmology, it actually will stabilize their understanding of who they are. So religion underpins and justifies much of who we think we are and what we do. Wars over scarce resources and wars over matters of belief are the most virulent and result in the greatest loss of life. When the two are combined, when a war is over resources and faith, then the body count is sure to be high. So returning to Mark Juergensmeyer, Juergensmeyer argues that globalization may be at the root of a lot of today's religious violence. And globalization is actually a concept that's linked to economies. And the idea is that globalization is the merging of world economies into one global economy. And so that means that, you know, if our stock plummets, it affects other countries in a negative way. However, this economic connection entails more interaction than ever before between different peoples and then more cultural exchange, because those people are traveling, they're communicating with each other, and we're getting this enormous amount of cultural exchange. Berger remarks that there is an emerging global culture, most of it Western and indeed American, both in origin and in content. Western culture, its style, fashion, films, music, idealism, ideology, etc., is permeating the rest of the world. Thus, our American ideas concerning romance, love and marriage, individualism, and freedom of choice are transmitted into cultures that, for example, have traditionally had arranged marriages, strict gender roles, and focus on the community over the individual. Globalization is inextricably linked with modernization, which encapsulates the ideals of democracy, freedom of the press, equality, reproductive choice, marriage equality, and other progressive ideas. And so non-Western cultures are being forced to grapple with the influx of new and modern ideas in a variety of ways. Now, first of all, it should be acknowledged that many of these countries embrace modernization and all it represents, and so don't feel any conflict or tension with it at all. And so more and more countries are entering the capitalist world economy and starting to advocate for progressive ideals, or at least some of them, that I just mentioned. So for example, to get into the UN, you have to meet a certain set of criteria for things like freedom of the press, human rights, no human rights violations, stuff like that, which are inherently sort of globalizing modern progressive ideals. And so many countries are more than happy to meet that challenge. However, the combined forces of globalization and modernization have also created pushbacks from any number of organizations or countries even, and many, if not most of them, are religious groups. In fact, factions right here in the United States resist the liberal forces of modernization, and our political landscape is characterized by differences of opinion of the role of religion in public life. And as a religious studies scholar, I would actually argue that a lot of our political disputes are actually over religion. And, or at the very least, certain values that religions carry as vehicles. About 23% of the American population is characterized as fundamentalist. And I'm going to return to that term in just a moment. But fundamentalists hold views that sort of the rest of the world, the other 77% of the world population, consider quite archaic. The tension between globalizing and modernizing forces dominates so much of our time and energy that Sam Huntington and James Hunter characterize it as a monolithic clash of civilizations. The idea here is that differing worldviews, even within a relatively homogeneous society, can be so polarizing that it can feel as though we are living in a war zone. Huntington presents the clash as being between conservative, or what he calls orthodox, religious people who uphold what we would consider sort of traditional values. The father is the head of the household and the breadwinner, repressed or at least underemphasized sexuality, the value of virginity upon marriage, things like that, religious devotion, social and fiscal conservatism, etc. People who fall into this camp understand themselves to literally be at war. And so you can understand war as sort of figurative struggle, but you can all, there are people out there right here in the United States who view themselves as being at war with the forces of liberalism or modernism, as I just characterized it. And so religious conservatives often see the modern world as irredeemably corrupt and perhaps even beyond saving. So as I said previously, religious identity is deeply ingrained into one's sense of self. And so Scott Appleby writes, about two-thirds of contemporary wars turn on issues of religious, ethnic, or national identity. And I would actually argue that these three things are often interrelated. And so religions encapsulate ethnicity and nationality. After all, how many times have we heard that America is a Christian nation? Remember, if you don't believe in God, you're not a real American. And which God are they talking about? They're talking about Shiva, Vishnu,
Kali.
That'd be cool. I could get behind that. Or for that matter, you know, we understand the Middle East to be Muslim. And so religious identity and national identity and ethnic identity are often sort of interrelated and interwoven. So whether or not Sam Huntington had all of the specifics correct in his Clash of Civilizations theory, most academics studying this topic agree with the basic premise that religious violence in the modern world arises when different groups have different visions for reality. When these visions are religious in nature, things tend to get ugly. And it might not just be that religious conservatives that place the imagery of tension, conflict, and war at the center of their religious ideologies. What I referred to as othering previously might actually be a hallmark of religion itself. So let us consider for a moment how some of the characteristics of religion in general are defined. There's a sociologist of religion named Christian Smith. And Christian Smith argues that religion's ability to foster and maintain tension is understood as leading to religious vitality. And he defines religious vitality as movements that attract members, raise money, and have engaged congregations. In his book, American Evangelicalism, Embattled and Thriving, Christian Smith argues that religion is about drawing sharp distinctions between the in-group and the out-group, and he argues that vitality is rooted in the maintenance of tension. He says, a religious group is strong not because it is shielded against, but because it is, or at least perceives itself to be, embattled with forces that seem to oppose or threaten it. Indeed, such a group thrives on distinction, engagement, tension, conflict, and threat. And so if there's not a threat out there, like if you're not actually being attacked, what do? You create one. You create one. So back to Mark Juergensmeyer. Mark Juergensmeyer wrote this book called Terror in the Mind of God, The Global Rise of Religious Violence. It's a great read. Well, if you like dark, gloomy stuff, which I do, so it's a great read. He says that acts of terrorism have much to do with the social tensions of this moment of history that cry out for absolute solutions. This is how he characterizes terrorists, people who commit acts of terrorism. He argues that terrorism is always the last option. But stay with me here. In order for there to be choices, you have to recognize those choices, or else they literally don't exist. And so if a person, like we, can stand over here in America and say, you know, those Palestinians, they need to engage in diplomacy. And, you know, maybe we're right. I'm certainly not suggesting that they shouldn't. And yet, the Palestinian on the ground living in the contested territory around Israel is going to have to recognize that diplomacy is a viable option that might actually work, or else it's not an option at all. And so acts of terrorism, according to Juergensmeyer's work, are acts of desperation. They are performed by desperate people who don't perceive any other option. Yeah?
Could it be not necessarily just desperate people, but people that, as you were kind of alluding to, don't have any other point of view to reference? Or is it that because they don't have that point of view to reference, desperation is the only thing they know?
Yes. I think some of both of that is at work. And so they don't have any other references, and so their options are limited. But of course, their options are limited because they don't have any other points of reference. And so it becomes sort of this vicious cycle. And actually, you know, one of the most effective things that we can do to people who are inclined toward violence is to offer them options and offer them choices. They have to be real choices, though. The person has to really recognize that this is a real and viable option. And if you offer them an option that doesn't have to do with blowing themselves or somebody else up, that's a real and viable option, most of them are like, yes, yes to that, yes, thank you. And they won't commit violence. And I can return to some of that in my concluding remarks as well. And so Juergensmeyer says, I don't think religion is the problem. But I do think that the involvement of religion in public life is often problematic. And so ultimately what Juergensmeyer concludes, he has this phrase called, it's hard to say, the religionization of politics. He says when politics become religionized, which is now a word, when politics become religionized, it often results in bad things happening. And sometimes bad things happening are one population being oppressed, but sometimes bad things are, you know, genocide. And so when your political structure is part and parcel of your religious structure, and your politics are rooted in an understanding of a cosmic reality, your politics become rigid, dogmatic, inflexible, and not subject to change. James Aho wrote this book called This Thing of Darkness, which might be one of my favorite book titles ever. And he argues in This Thing of Darkness that religion, by its very nature, others, in the sense that it advocates a truth claim that is rooted in cosmic reality. Anyone who does not accept the truth claim is the other, the one who is different. In the words of James Aho, the warrior needs an enemy. If an enemy is not ontologically present in the nature of things, one must be manufactured. We create our enemies. And so a lot of our religions, particularly Christianity and Islam, cast themselves, believers, in this idea of being warriors for God. And we can argue all day that that's, you know, figurative, that we're supposed to, you know, commit war against temptation in our lives, you know, things like that. And yet, it's this war language and this sort of violent mythology is sort of deeply rooted into certain mythological structures. And so what Aho is arguing, and he is talking specifically about Christianity here, by the way, that's what his book is about. He says that when you have this warrior mentality, then in order to be a warrior, you need what? An enemy. And so if one is not ontologically present, if one is not there staring you in the face, then you manufacture one. And then finally, Hector Avalos, who wrote this book called Fighting Words, The Origins of Religious Violence. Hector Avalos is probably the strongest scholar that I use in my own work. He thinks that religion is inherently violent. He thinks that it is fundamentally violent, and that if it's not resulting in war, terrorism, and genocide, that it's probably resulting in slavery, oppression, and, you know, repression, and other bad things. He says religion is inherently prone to violence because religious conflict relies solely on resources whose scarcity is wholly manufactured by or reliant on unverifiable premises. His argument is that religion creates and maintains tension by mediating between believers and a desired good, such as salvation, which is an unverifiable premise. You can't verify salvation. You can believe in it, but you can't verify it. His argument, followers valuing the desired good, salvation, above all else, are driven into a heightened state of anxiety over the perceived unlikelihood of achieving the unverified resource, creating circumstances that are ripe for violence. Religion, as characterized by Avalos, is in the business of creating orienting worldviews that, when exposed to differing worldviews, begin to crumble and shake. The religious person, feeling his or her cosmos tremble, lashes out violently. Violence erupts when people are frightened, and fear can be traced back to scarcity, actual or perceived, of resources that are tangible, such as food, education, healthcare, jobs, etc., to the intangible, such as feelings of safety and a sense of security that all is right with the world. Ultimately, a resource is anything believed to be necessary or advantageous to a certain mode of living. And according to Avalos, when religion causes violence, it often does so because it has created new scarce resources. According to Avalos, what religion does is it says, see this thing right here, this is the most important thing in the world, and there's only one of it, and you have it, and you must protect it. And so what that does is the people who have this scarce resource that's totally manufactured to begin with, they get really nervous and they start thinking, ooh, she's looking at me kind of funny, I don't know, you know, I have to protect this. And it creates this sort of heightened sense of anxiety and paranoia, which can actually cause people to lash out preemptively even when there's nothing there threatening them. That's what Avalos argues. So, religious conflict. It appears that the nature of religion is ambivalent. It contains, in varying degrees, elements that contribute to both war and peace. And so, You can ask me in the question and answer and put me on the spot whether or not I think religion is inherently violent or not. It's a difficult and complicated question. But it does seem that if we're just going to look out sort of at the religious landscape, that sometimes religion is actually primed to really promote peace. And some of the greatest world leaders have been religious people who were deeply grounded in their faith. And yet we also have incredible acts of violence that result in untold bloodshed and war. So fundamentalism is a term that we hear a lot in the media. and I'm going to define it for you right now as we use it in religious studies. Fundamentalism actually started by talking about a very specific branch of American Christianity that was formed in the 1920s, but now we use it much more broadly. So this is a long quote, I'm going to work you through it. So fundamentalism is the belief that one has access to an infallible source of authority. In other words, my authority is right and yours is wrong. That source of authority may be a text, a tradition, a leader, or a combination of these. The fundamentalist, whether Jewish, Christian, Muslim, Hindu, or Buddhist, is certain that he or she knows the truth, with a capital T, and that truth resides in an idealized earlier way of religious life and one to which we should return. That lost golden age that we're all trying to get back to? There is no openness to alternative points of view. Fundamentalism involves the belief that pure good is battling pure evil and that we, of course, are on the side of good. This dualistic perspective pits believers against unbelievers, us versus them. So that's how we define fundamentalist. Yeah.
So that makes it sound like this came about pretty much with the invention of monotheism. Because, you know, before Zoroastrianism, which I know I butchered it.
Zoroastrianism.
That's it, yes, thank you. You know, that was the first one that there was a monotheistic religion, but then there's this evil deity that it had to fight.
Yes.
Whereas in the polytheistic religions, even in Hinduism, you had the destructive and creative forces, and it was understood that they needed
to exist as part of a whole.
Right.
And so there have definitely been there's definitely been moments of what could be characterized as religious violence in the Eastern world. Buddhism has actually, ironically, been involved in some pretty heinous religious wars in, for example, Sri Lanka. And there was one of the longest ongoing civil wars ever, 35 years of civil war on a very small island. Sri Lanka is not big. It lasted for 35 years, I believe, and resulted in the complete and total annihilation of one side. They literally drove them into the sea and slaughtered them by the hundreds of thousands. And that's what ultimately ended the civil war in Sri Lanka. And it was Buddhists. And some Hindus and some Muslims, but the Buddhists were right up in there fighting tooth and nail. And so there's a debate about whether or not it's just monotheism. So now let me talk just a little bit about the work that I do. You guys know what this is?
Oklahoma.
So in 1995, a man named Timothy McVeigh with his friend Terry Nichols bombed the federal building in Oklahoma City. And it resulted in the loss of 167 lives, I believe. It was the largest terrorist strike on American soil by an American. And until 9/11, it was the largest terrorist strike on American soil ever, of all time. Timothy McVeigh was a believer in this movement known as Christian Identity. And he wasn't a member of an actual church. But he had all of the literature, and he was talking to all of the leaders of that movement. And so Christian identity can be characterized in the following beliefs. I am going to assume that the audience has at least a passing familiarity with the creation story found in Genesis. If you don't, ask me to clarify, and I can. Okay. So Christian identity believes that God created humanoid creatures along with the other animals before placing Adam into the Garden of Eden. So he created monkeys and snakes and bears and lions and tigers, oh my. And he also created like apes, and they call them apes, who were basically like very intelligent apes, otherwise known as black people. The serpent is not an actual snake, but is the devil himself. And interestingly, this can actually be traced to medieval art, What you have here is you have Eve accepting the apple, and look at this. Look at this person. So Christian identity believes that the devil, in something resembling a human form, was present in the Garden of Eden. Furthermore, they believe that original sin is not Eve's disobedience, Adam and Eve's disobedience, but is actually Eve having sex with the serpent. He gives her the apple. She's like, oh, I'm feeling all sexy now. And they have sex. This means that Abel and Seth, and I can get into this genealogy in a second, are the only true born sons of Adam, and that they are racially white. They are white people. They look like me. Cain is the son of the devil, and he is colored, a Jew, the biological son of Satan on earth. So what happens in the story is that Adam and Eve have these children, and so Cain is born first. Christian identity believes that Cain is Eve and the devil. So then Eve has sex with Adam and produces Abel, and Cain kills Abel. Christian identity believers think that that act of fratricide started the war between God and the devil, and that it is literally a war between biological descendants of the devil and the creations of God. They racialize this entire thing. They think, of course, God curses Cain for killing Abel and puts a mark upon his skin. Christian identity believes that the mark upon the skin was darkness, dark skin. Yeah.
The Bible says that the mark of Cain was to protect him from people saying, well, you killed your brother and brought.
Right.
So that this is turning the Bible around and ignoring.
Just a little. Just a little. And so actually, I've gotten pretty involved with this community and have started sort of seeing how they answer questions like that. And many of them will actually, well, it depends on which version of the Bible they can use to best justify their beliefs. I talked about religion being fluid before. And so some of them are interested in Hebrew interpretations, and some of them are interested in the original Greek. And so one of the things that they will do is they will actually learn Hebrew and Greek, and then translate back and forth between the two languages in order to discover God's truth, which is available only to them. Right? It's available only to them. And so this is just like scratching the surface of what they actually believe. And so what they then do is they trace the lineage, racial lineage through the Bible to indicate that Jesus was white, and that Jesus, they call him the kinsman redeemer. And what that means is that Jesus came to this earth to redeem only white people. His message is only for whites. And so you can't actually be Christian unless you're white. So,
Jesus was a Jew.
Okay, but except they have three different interpretations of the word Jew. So one interpretation of the word Jew means geographic location. And that's how they say Jesus was a Jew, in the same way that they say Jesus is of Nazareth. They use it as to like identify the location that he was from. This is also how they explain things like King David, Moses, Noah, all of these other Old Testament prophets that who also have to be white in order for Jesus to be white. And so they use Jew as a geographic location. The other two ways that they use Jew is demons in human form, masquerading as humans. And then they also use Judaism as a satanic religion that is believed by the demons masquerading in human form. So the other, and perhaps most important for religious violence question, is that most Christian identity people believe that the War of Armageddon is happening right now. Right now. It's already begun. And so they will commit acts of violence against people believing that they are doing God's will or that they are defending themselves against antichrists. And so a member of the Montana Freeman back in the 1990s was pulled over for having a taillight out in Wyoming. He was driving across Wyoming. He was pulled over for having a taillight out. Black deputy gets out of the police car and he shoots him. Bang, dead, no questions. In court, when he was asked to explain his actions, he said, I was being attacked by a demon. I was defending myself. So Mark Juergensmeyer argues that it is this group of people that pose the most threat to American lives. And so, in the 1980s, in 1983 and 84, and those of you who are living in Colorado are paying attention to what was going on in Colorado. Yeah?
How did Orientals figure into this?
Oh, they're really conflicted about that, actually. And so some of them say that Orientals are sort of not worthy of conversation, and others of them say, well, they're sort of these pre-Adamic humanoid people, you know, things that were created in the Garden of Eden. They're not really human. And others of them actually say that, oh, the Orientals are pretty cool, as long as they stay over there. And they can have China and stuff, like, we don't care about that, but they need to stay over there. And so, one of the most interesting and disturbing events occurred in 1983 and 1984. And so some of you who may have been living here at the time, there was a talk show host in Denver named Alan Berg. And he was assassinated, effectively. He was assassinated by three Christian Identity people. And one of them was Richard Scuteri, who I'll show you in just a moment. And so these Christian Identity is often conflated with the neo-Nazis. They use a lot of the same symbols. And so they often use the swastikas, the white power salute. And this is a march in Germany, which consider the irony of that, in 2002. And so quite a lot of them. And so in 1983, three Christian Identity members murdered Alan Berg. He insulted one of a Christian Identity pastor, and they were enacting their revenge. Of course, Alan Berg was also Jewish, and so therefore an antichrist. And so they were committing God's work by doing that. But what that murder ultimately led to was one of the largest busts in FBI and ATF history. There was an organization that consisted of 22 people. 22 people. And they set out to take over America. That was their goal. There were 22 of them, taking over America. The first thing they did was they started a counterfeiting organization. They entered over $10 million of counterfeit money into the American monetary system. They used that money to buy high caliber weapons, and they started hitting army bases. Furthermore, they recruit from army bases. And so Fort Bragg is missing things like, anti-aircraft missiles are missing from Fort Bragg. The order, they did a heist where they held up an armored car. They walked off with just under $5 million in cash. They used that $5 million, they bought a tank, they bought an airplane, and they bought enough C4 to blow up a city the size of Atlanta. When Alan Berg was murdered, that ultimately led to the arrest of the order. They took them apart. It took them a while, but they took them apart. When they ultimately took the order down, it came to light in certain circles that they were within 4 months of moving on the city of Los Angeles. They were targeting the military base there, and they wanted to take over the military base and gain access to all of the planes, the tanks, the nuclear weapons. I mean, who knows what all is at that base? And taking over that base, and then they were going to set up camp in Los Angeles and use that as a starting point to take over the rest of the country. And they were styling this this activity after a novel known as The Turner Diaries, which basically chronicles this exact type of event. And what they were going to do is they were going to round up all black people and Jews and anyone who had had sex with a black person or a Jew and hang them. Yeah?
So there's been a recent event in North Dakota where a group of white supremacists has taken over
town. Leith, North Dakota.
Yeah. So, you know, North Dakota is home to a large stock of nuclear weapons, and Minot Air Force Base and the whole Underground Rail system. So you may not know, but is it plausible that they have this similar intention starting there?
I would say that it's no doubt that they do. Yeah, it's no doubt that they do. So what they want to do is they believe that if they can establish a homeland for white people in the United States, that it will fulfill the biblical book, the biblical prophecy in the book of Revelation of returning to the new Israel. So they think that the United States is the new Israel mentioned in the book of Revelation. And if they can capture the United States for white people, that it will usher in the second coming of Christ, which of course they want to happen. And so they're trying to actually bring about Armageddon. That's what they're ultimately doing.
Yeah, but why are we spending so much time talking about lunatic fringe groups? We should be talking about the real issues of religion and violence. I mean,
so what would you like to discuss?
We can always find crazy people who have these impossible, crazy, egomaniac
sure.
dreams and visions, you know, but the chances of one tank and one plane is not going to cut it, you know. So, you know, and the notion of taking over nuclear bombs.
And you want us to keep interrupting you, or you want to finish and then have questions and answers?
We can start the question and answer.
That's what they claim to do, but it's not going to happen, okay?
I mean, we're sort of running out of toward the end of our time, so that's fine.
So,
so let me ask you this. What is the real issue?
What
is the real issue?
The real issue is, what is religion, you know? How did it relate to the major acts of violence in the 20th century? And I don't think it really did. The major acts of violence were committed by communists, okay? And the hammer and sickle is one of your symbols up there.
Mm-hmm.
But the communists, as you know, were atheists.
Ostensibly.
And Nazis in Germany had nothing to do, really, essentially, with Christianity. It was a separate ideology created by Hitler and Goebbels.
Sure.
And
let me say two things.
It wasn't the church and the religious groups that did this. It was the Nazi party.
So let me say two things.
Who went along with them? Okay.
So let me say two things.
What?
Two things.
Okay.
So first of all, I find Christian identity interesting as a case study that illuminates larger complexities having to do with how religion is utilized, not just within Christian identity circles, but within the world at large, to rationalize religious acts. And so ultimately, my goal and my area of interest is, how do we communicate with these people in order to get them to stop? And in order to be able to communicate with them effectively, we have to understand their religious worldviews. And if fundamentalism, and Christian identity is a form of fundamentalism, if fundamentalism is sort of inherently problematic, then one of our questions and our jobs should be to figure out how to adequately address the concerns and needs of fundamentalists in order to bring down the temperature, as it were, and make them less likely to commit acts of violence. Now, secondly, With regards to your point of sort of fascism, right? The fascist movements, including the Nazi movements, which were atheistic and in fact sort of anti-religious. So many scholars actually use these events to say that the underlying problems are not religious in nature at all, but are in fact socioeconomic inequalities, racial tensions. Then what happens is that religion gets sort of co-opted in to justify and rationalize even, and not always, right? And so it doesn't always happen. And so other scholars have argued very convincingly that maybe we actually don't need to be looking at religion as much. We need to be looking at socioeconomic inequality. And if we can address those issues, then the other issues will sort of resolve themselves. And so ultimately what I want to leave you with is this idea that there are different perspectives on the role that religion plays in violent activity and violent people. And then let me just say one more thing as an aside. So this is a radical fringe group, and they have committed more hate crimes than all of the people who were killed on September 11th combined. Since 1980, this group of people has killed 3,000 or 4,000 people. And they continue to do so. And hate crimes are actually on the rise. And hate crimes against Jews and blacks and Mexicans in particular have risen incrementally over the last 10 years. And these people are deeply involved in a lot of that activity. So they are very violent. And so my feeling is that if we discount them as a fringe group, we don't pay enough attention to them. and they're out there, like, killing people. Yeah, Sam?
So if we don't pay attention to them, their activities will increase to attention?
Well, I think we need to figure out what it is that they want. And so, okay, so let me break it down. Let me be a little psychological here for a second. So let's say that the root of this racial hatred is actually lack of opportunities and access to things like jobs. So one of the things you'll hear a lot in these communities is that, you know, they are taking our jobs, that the welfare state is draining out access to resources, stuff like that. And so maybe what we should do is we should take a very close and careful look at, you know, sort of the economic situation that these people are living in. And so, and if we can start to address some of those economic concerns, then some of that other stuff may work itself out. Now, yeah, so turning our back on them is also a really scary prospect because they have guns. And so sort of ignoring them entirely is probably not going to work because they likely will escalate. Some people are saying that we should invite them to the table and listen to their concerns. Now, of course, you have to get past the racism. I think you had a question.
You made my comment.
Oh, okay.
I was wondering what the socioeconomic status of these kinds of religious fringe people are. Are they on the fringe economically?
Most of them are actually working class. And so there's a working class population, which of course has been hit particularly hard in the most recent, you know, downturn, economic downturn. And so they're certainly feeling that stress and pressure. Most of them are not actually impoverished. It's not like they're losing their homes. That most of them do have some form of job and employment. But many of them will say that they don't have the level of employment that they deserve.
They're underemployed.
Right. Yes, you, sir.
Ma'am, when you finish your presentation, then you can start discussion.
Oh, let's do it right now. I thought we were already doing that.
Are you done?
Yeah. We can totally transition into talking about whatever you guys want to talk about.
When you started something here, we didn't say anything about it.
Oh, yeah, no, that's fine.
You finish your presentation.
Yes, ma'am.
What is the relationship between religion and one's educational level?
It's complicated. And so lower people with less education tend to be more religious. But that's actually kind of an oversimplification. People with lower education tend to be more religious in more conservative and fundamentalist ways. So people with a lot of education, for example, might be religious, but they're going to be a member of like a progressive Protestant church or something like that, as opposed to a more conservative evangelical church, for example. And that's pretty true worldwide. People who are lower on the economic totem pole and lower access to education tend to be more religious, generally speaking. Other questions? Yeah.
How do religious scholars view, like, I guess, say, like, violence in the other direction, like secularists, relatively secular people against religious people, like, say, the coup in Egypt, and the crackdown on the Muslim Brotherhood by the relatively secular military, the relatively secular population. Like, how do they view that? Like, it's
right.
Kind of the inverse. You know?
Having been in Egypt in May, right before the revolution, I have some interesting thoughts on that. So in Egypt, about 95% of the population is Muslim. And the most progressive Muslims are still really religious by our standards. And so, I mean, really, really quite devout. And so the argument is over the role of religion at the government level, the role of religion in politics. That's the argument. So people across Egypt are very, very religious, just in general. And, you know, obviously you get really extreme versions of religion too, but they're very religious. And so the argument is about the role of religion in politics, not the role or importance of religion overall. And Egypt is actually a really interesting study because you have very religious people fighting other very religious people. And it's over the role of politics. And so I met many people and spoke with many people when I was in Egypt who would say things like, oh, I am the most devout Muslim that there is, and I'm a secularist. And what they meant was that they don't believe that Islam should form the basis of the governmental and political structure in Egypt. And the Muslim Brotherhood believes differently. Egypt has its work cut out for it, because of course Morsi was a democratically elected president who they just overthrew. So we're going to see what happens there now. Does that answer your question, Brian?
Yeah, I was just considering, like you know, we were talking about violent religious people,
sure.
Like fringe groups, granted, but I was just thinking like the opposite case, you know.
Right.
Especially like how would that one scholar you said religion is the root of violence account for the secular people?
Right, committing violence.
People.
Yeah, he certainly doesn't say that non-religious people don't commit violence, because of course there's all sorts of economic and political and geographic, racial inequalities out there that people can get upset about whether or not they're religious. He just tends to think that religion is like grease on the fire. Yes, you.
What's the basis of the Christian view, or at least some Christian, that Israel must be supported and protected?
Oh, like Zionism?
Yeah.
The religious view?
Yeah, I mean, I've read that, you know, there's a large movement among Christians to be sure that Israel is supported by the U.S.
Yeah.
And
so,
based on some biblical...
Yes. Yeah, so the question is what is sort of the religious basis for the belief that America, the country, the nation, should support the nation of Israel? Like, what's the religious basis of that? Well, the religious basis of that has to do with the covenant, the land of the covenant. And so, according to the Hebrew Bible, the Christian Old Testament, God gave Abraham actually this plot of land. And so Israel is right here, but the biblical covenant and sort of encompasses this piece of territory right here. And if you combine this understanding of the covenant between God and the people of Abraham, the descendants of Abraham, with the Christian book of Revelation, the book of Revelation suggests that Jesus will return in the second coming once the people of Abraham occupy the land of the covenant, which they never have in the history of the world. They haven't actually occupied this territory. And so some American Christian religious groups are very, very interested in supporting Israel in order to fulfill the covenant so that the second coming can happen. Do you have a follow-up question?
Yeah, kind of.
Go ahead.
It's almost like Revelations was a humorous book of the Bible. And it's like when pigs fly.
Oh, right. So, yeah, so more of a comment that, you know, perspectives on the book of Revelation vary. And so some people sort of, actually, the book of Revelation wasn't even included in the Christian Bible for a really long time because it was considered sort of a prophetic dream vision, you know, that was kind of interesting, but that was sort of it. But other people really accord it a lot of seriousness and think that, you know, they're mining the world for these biblical seals that indicate when Jesus will come again. Yeah, yeah.
The people of the Muslim faith also are children of Abraham, so.
Yes.
So that, you know.
Yes. Yeah, it's really complicated. Like, who are the children of Abraham? Are they the Jews? Or are they the Jews and the Christians? Because, I mean, come on, this is the Middle East. It's occupied by a lot of Muslims, so aren't they sort of already there? Yeah, absolutely. There were a couple of other hands of people who haven't spoken. In the back in the blue shirt and then up.
Yeah, I think you said that the big danger is when a nation identifies itself with religion.
That can be a problem.
say
again.
Are there any nations that don't identify themselves with one religion?
That's a good question. Marianne, help me out here.
Say Germany is an example.
Germany
is a religion is divided between
Protestant and Catholic. So there's
Sweden.
France. France, actually, I don't think does. Yeah, there are, Canada doesn't, wait, is there a Canadian church?
Our country doesn't identify itself as one religion.
So let's clarify here, because you can have a state religion, like the Anglican Church is the Church of England, right? But of course, only 2% of Brits actually go to the Anglican Church. And so you can have a state church without actually a whole lot of adherence.
We don't have a state
church. And we don't have a state church, and yet we have a high level of religiosity. And many, sort of the 75% of people who identify as Christian, many of them will say things like America is a Christian nation. We certainly reference God a lot, and by God we mean the Judeo-Christian God. And yet we don't have a state religion. And so, it gets complicated. And so there are some sort of purely secular states, like Germany is a purely secular state. But again, you still have religiosity. You have religious Germans. Yeah. Although you certainly do get varying degrees of religiosity. We actually have a really high level of religiosity for a quote-unquote secular state. Whereas, you know, in England, even where you do have the Anglican Church, you have very low degrees of religious adherence, very low scales of religiosity. Phil, what was your question?
So I walked in a little late, and I don't know if you brought this up earlier, but is this perspective of the relationship between religion and violence, is this more of a modern, say, like the last 300-400 years sort of thing, or have they been able to trace it back to, say, the Romans, the Greeks,
yep,
the Druids, all of that?
Sure. It depends on who you ask. So Hector Avalos says that religious violence predates globalization by a really long time. And he used these things like the Crusades, the Inquisitions, the Muslims conquering everything from Spain to India during the 8th century. He uses examples like that to back up his claim. Other people say that this sort of modern context really is sort of modern, sort of very new, and that even though we saw religious wars in the past, we're seeing religious wars play out in different ways in the modern context. So it's complicated, and it depends on who you ask. Yeah, Marianne?
Well, I was just going to speak to the point that was made earlier about why would you focus on this tiny French group? 1923, the German Workers' Party was a tiny French group that had 25 members.
25.
They joined it, turned it into the Nazi Party, and by 1930, it was the second largest party in
Germany. Yeah.
So we should never
overlook
people like you're talking about.
Interesting. Yeah, that's true. I didn't actually know it started out with only 25. I thought it was at least a couple hundred.
In a beer hall, right?
In a beer hall. Yeah. Yeah.
He was voted into office. Okay.
He was not voted into office.
He wasn't voted into office.
Well, he was appointed by the Hindenburg, and then.
You should talk to her right there. She's our World War II Hitler Nazi expert right there. And so I think we've actually come to the end of our time today. And so if you have questions, I'm happy to hang out and answer them. But in the meantime, enjoy the rest of your evening. Thanks for having me.
Thank you.